the Boarding Mesa Church. Let the church say amen. Let the church say amen again. Let the church say amen one more time. Amen. What a joy it is for us to be back in Arizona. My family and I were on vacation on last week. We were gone for 6 days, and we visited 4 states in 6 days. So I need a vacation from my vacation. And I just want to thank you for enduring last week's heat for us on our behalf. Thank you so much. We did not have to experience 121 degree last week, so thank you for sacrificing for us. But we are definitely glad to be back, and we really appreciate the love and the embracing that you've done on our return. Terry has been preaching a series on the distorted images of God, what they are, where they come from, and how we remedy those. So I would like to also continue and add to the discussion on Terry's series, and I want to invite you to the subject this morning, in his image. In his image. Did you know that images are a part of our everyday life? Images are very, very important. We can't avoid them. When you think about Thanksgiving, there's an image for that. When you think about Christmas, there's an image for that. When you think about your marriage ceremony or your first date, there are images for that. When you think about 9/11, where you were when that event took place, there are images for that. When you think about your parents, and for some of you, your parents may have passed on to the next life, but there are images for that as well. Images are a part of our everyday life. Our memories, our ideas, our experiences, our thoughts are all accompanied by images. And sometimes these images can create problems in our lives. If our images aren't challenged, if our images aren't changed, they can even have a negative effect on our behavior. For images can override our rationality. The idea is that thoughts create images, which in turn create our reality. When we think about manufacturers, those who produce the vape devices, they use images to get you to buy their products. They present these products in such a way that they make you think that they're healthier than cigarettes, that they don't cause as much harm as a cigarette or a cigar, but there are negative consequences to vaping. But we buy into the images that media wants to sell us, and so we go against our rationality and we purchase these products. Some of you may be familiar with the image in the middle. That's an iPhone X. An iPhone X! That phone costs $1,000. Who in the right mind would pay $1,000 for a cell phone? Let me put my iPhone X back in my pocket. But the images that these marketing agencies feed us, they're so powerful that they cause us to believe what they're selling. And so we go against our rationality, and we pay $1,000 for a cell phone. Images are powerful. How many of you enjoy a nice, juicy Big Mac? Now, we all know that 100%. It's 100% all natural, unfrozen beef. So that's one real burger. But the rest of the burgers are not real. And we know this. We know they're not healthy for us. We know fast food clogs our arteries. We know it brings on heart disease if we don't use moderation. But we buy it anyway. Why? Images are powerful. So I want to use this idea as we continue the subject on distorted images of God. I want to ask you this morning, what is your image of God? How do you see God? Distorted images of God can result in countless moments of confessing sins. Distorted images of God can result in constantly asking and begging God for your forgiveness. It can result in overwhelming fear of making the wrong choices or doing the wrong thing. But on the opposite side, this distorted image of God can result in a lack of morals. It can look like unhealthy tolerance of immoral behavior. A distorted image of God can look like endorsing and viewing all behavior as permissible. It can look like indulgence in sin. A distorted image of God can also look like apathetic obedience, where we believe all God wants from us is good behavior. He just wants us to do the right thing. And so there's no emotional connection, but it makes us just simply go through the motions of Christianity without any emotional attachment to it. In Galatians chapter 3, looking at verse number 1, many of you are familiar with the book of Galatians, and the Bible talks about how the Galatians had received the gospel, and somehow they were convinced by Judaizers that there was another gospel, a gospel of works, a gospel that was somehow intertwined with the law of Moses. And so they fell away from the original gospel that was presented to them by the apostles. And so in Galatians chapter 3, verse 1, Paul says, "You foolish Galatians, who has hypnotized you, before whose eyes Jesus Christ was vividly portrayed as crucified?" Now, your translation may read a little bit different, but there's two schools of thought here. One translation suggests that the Galatians weren't there during the crucifixion of Jesus. And so Paul is saying, we have portrayed the crucifixion to you so vividly as if you were there witnessing the crucifixion of Christ. The other school of thought is that the Galatians were there at the crucifixion of Jesus. And so they did see the image of Christ hanging there on the cross. And Paul is saying, we've given you this description of Christ on the cross so vividly that there's no way that that image should escape your heart so that you turn away from the gospel. And yet they did. Because the Judaizers came in and they presented another gospel, a different image of Christ. And it caused them to turn away from the truth. Images are powerful. As we contemplate our distorted images of God, Jesus says that Satan is the father of what? Satan is the father of lies. So a distorted image of God results in a lie about God. Therefore, Satan is the origin of these distorted images. Distorted beliefs about God. What are they? What do they sound like? What do they look like? Here's one. God is present, but not all-powerful. He sees my hurt, he sees my pain and suffering, but he can't do anything about it.
distortion. How about this one? God is like Santa Claus. He only blesses me when I behave. Therefore, his love is conditional. Distortion. Here's another one. God is like a bystander. He's a stranger. He's cold. He's distant. He's uninvolved and disinterested in my life. God simply watches us from afar. Distortion. Here's one more. God is like the President of the United States. He's powerful, but he's truly not interested in our well-being. He has the power to help us, but refuses to. Distortion. Church, what we believe about God and our deep-seated images of God may be at odds with one another. So what do you mean, Josh? We can readily articulate a theological description of God. God is all-powerful. God is all-loving. God is omnipresent. He's everywhere at the same time. We may be able to talk about God and attribute particular attributes to God, but what we feel about God may be very inconsistent because of our distorted image of him. How do you see God? Do you see God as the judge? Do you see God as a bully? Do you see God as a compassionate friend? Do you see God as a harsh parent? It seems that people who believe in a God of love and compassion sometimes experiences private images of God that are emotionally disturbing, because images are powerful. Well, how are these distorted images created? Give me a moment to kind of build an answer to this question. In Genesis chapter 1, verse 27, a verse that we're all familiar with, it says, so God created mankind in his own what? Image. In the image of God, he created them, male and female, he created them. There's something very interesting about this passage. I noticed two things. Number one, that males or men are created in God's image. That there are certain attributes of a man or of a male that image the character of God. On the flip side, women or females are also created in God's image. And so there are particular attributes of a female that males do not possess that still image the character of God. It's powerful. And I like to emphasize that point because we often forget that male and female are distinctively different. And that's okay. That gender behaviors is a result of biology and not society. Amen, church. Therefore, when you have a man and a woman together, it takes both a man and a woman to truly image the characteristics of God. Well, what does it mean to be created in God's image? The Hebrew word for image translates to a shadow, which is an outline or representation of the original. So it doesn't mean that we look like God or that God looks like us, but there are certain characteristics about us that resemble the image of God. We have particular non-divine attributes that we share with our Creator. Some of them are the freedom of the will. We don't live by instincts like animals do. we can actually make choices. We can choose to do some things and choose not to do other things. We have free will. We are rational thinkers. That's God is also a rational thinker. Animals that can't think rationally, but mankind can. Even though sometimes we don't look too rational. Another attribute or quality we share with God is that we're personal. We're interpersonal. We relate to one another. Relationships are a necessity in this life. And we understand that only through our relationship with God. God himself is in relationship with himself in the form of the Trinity, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. God is a relational God. And he has made us to be in relationship not only with him, but with one another. We can create like God creates. There are magnificent paintings, sculptures, architectural structures that man has created. Even looking at technology, man can create. Well, where did that come from? The Creator. We image God. The Bible tells us that we have dominion over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air and everything in this world. Except one another. That we have authority over things and dominion over things just as God has dominion and authority over us. We are emotional as God is emotional with us. The image of God marks us out from all other living creatures, which by implication are not made in his image. If we have a distorted or skewed image of God, we will also have a distorted image of who we are, because we are made in his image. That helps me to know that when we project on God these distorted images and qualities that are not of God, sometimes it's really a reflection on what we think about ourselves. Amen, church? In Genesis chapter 5, verse 3, it says, when Adam had lived 130 years, he had a son in his own likeness, in his own image, and he named him Seth. So this helps us to understand what it means to be made in God's image. Seth was not a result of Adam's mental design or creative thinking process, but rather an indication that in many ways, Seth, his son, resembled the character, the temperaments, the physical appearance of Adam, his father. Does that make sense? But there were certain traits about Seth that you saw in Adam. And there are certain traits about us as human beings that you can see in God. The main idea is that man is like his maker. In Genesis chapter 9, verse 6, you may say, well, when you look at Adam and Eve being created, they were created without sin. It was a pre-fallen world. So they naturally looked like God, but our image is now flawed, and so we no longer look like God. So you may say, after the fall, our image of God and our likeness concerning God has changed. And I say, no, it hasn't. This verse says, whoever sheds the blood of man, by man shall his blood be shed. For God made man in his what? Image. This was after sin had entered the world. And we are still made in God's image, even though we sin. Amen, church. This implies that in man's fallen state, we still image our God. I want to take a moment to present to you two rights as God's image bearers. Number one, all humanity has a right to life. All humanity has a right to live and not have his or her life taken by anyone. Amen, church. Is that not what the Bible says? Whoever sheds the blood of man, by man shall his blood be shed, for God made man in his own image. We should value human life. Right number two, a right to be treated with dignity and respect. Let me say that again. We have a right as God's image bearers to be treated with dignity and respect. No matter how sinful we are. I didn't hear any amens on that one. James chapter 3, verse 9. With the tongue we praise our Lord and Father, and with it we curse human beings who have been made in God's likeness. This verse isn't just concerning those who are believers, but it's also referring to the unbeliever. How is it that as Christians, we can sing these wonderful praises to God, pray these wonderful prayers, and bless his name, but then we curse other human beings who are made in his image? We disrespect them. We humiliate them. We embarrass them. What about those who are marginalized in this country? What about those who are poor? Those who are victimized. Those who are the perpetrators. Those who have felonies. Those who have addictions. Those who we would rather turn a blind eye to and not see their plight and their pain and their suffering. Or we may talk badly about them, dehumanizing them. James says this ought not be. We even curse those who are politically opposed to our beliefs. Amen, church. As human beings made in God's image, we all have a right to dignity and respect. When it comes to these distorted images of God, we know that we as humans are made in his image. But as humans, we fail miserably. So what is the true image of God? How do we know what attributes to associate God with? Where do these distorted and skewed images of God come from? I suggest that they come from us. Because nothing else in this world has been created in God's image but you and I. So if there are distorted images of God, it may be because of how we relate to one another. All humanity is made in God's image. Therefore, humanity must take responsibility in distorting the true image of God through ungodly motives and amen, church. The more we surround ourselves with people who misrepresent God's image, the more our image of God will remain distorted. You get that? Because humanity is God's image bearers. But it's also responsibility to us as believers that we have a charge to make sure that in our interactions with one another, we look like God. Amen, church. To understand spiritual terms and concepts, we associate them with life experiences. Many of these associations are correlated with people. Attempting to understand what it means to be a child of God, I naturally think about or image our children. When attempting to understand God as my Father, I naturally think about the only earthly father that I have. And I use that as a way to understand what it means for God to be my Father. When we reflect back on our history here in the United States, and you think about the image of a burning cross, what do you think about? White supremacy? KKK? A spiritual image that has been used for evil. That distorts people's image of God. When we think about the gay pride movement, what do they use to represent their lifestyle? A rainbow. Something created by God as a promise to the world that he would not flood the earth again. But again, this is a spiritual reality in which people have used for evil. And it creates a distorted image of God. So I ask you today, if your image of God is distorted, I want you to attempt to identify significant people in your life that have caused you harm. People that have caused you misfortune, pain, suffering, abuse. They may provide the very insight needed for you to better understand your distorted image of God. Unfortunately, our relationships are often the cause of these misrepresented images of God. Sometimes it's family. Sometimes it's the preacher. Sometimes it's the church. Sometimes it's our own belief system. Sometimes it's the teacher. I remember John Boulay stood up here 2 weeks ago doing the communion. And I remember him stating that as his family fell apart, so did his image of God. I remember John saying that Grandma always told stories of God's anger and judgment, which created negative images of a cold, distant dictator. The same is true for me. As I think about my father, absent, not present in my life, uninvolved, disinterested, not caring about my well-being, you know, I felt the same way about God. My image of God was a God who was unaware of me. God knew I existed. He knew that I was alive, but he had no true interest in me. He saw me, and he saw my sin, but didn't really care about it. God was real, but he was emotionally and relationally unavailable to me. We have to take responsibility for our distorted images of God. Ultimately, God's image is distorted by the sin of mankind. Amen? Let's take a brief look at Jesus. Jesus was a man in God's image. If you look at 1 Timothy chapter 2, the verses 5, it says, "For there is one God and one mediator between God and humanity, the man, Christ Jesus." I think Paul was very intentional on using the term man when referring to Christ. We know that Christ was God, but Christ was also man. The Bible tells us that Christ put on flesh. He went through the birth process, as we all have gone through. The cross, in some sense, was a created being in its fleshly form, knowing that he has always been divine and he has no beginning and no end. But for emphasis' sake, Christ shares with us, as a created being, the attributes of God. Christ, too, could create like we create. He was a carpenter, right? He could build things. Christ could think rational as we think rational. Christ was emotional as we are emotional. Christ had to grow up and mature into adulthood just like we do. On a very basic level, we share qualities with Christ, as we do with God. But God revealed a more accurate image of himself through the incarnation of Jesus. Amen, church. In John chapter 14, verses 7 through 9, Jesus is talking to his disciples. He says, "If you really know me, you will know my Father. From now on, you do know him and have seen him." Philip said, "Lord, show us the Father, and that will be enough for us." And then Jesus answered, "Don't you know me, Philip? Even after I have been among you for so long, don't you know me? Don't you know that anyone who has seen me has seen who? The Father." And then Jesus says, "How can you say, 'Show us the Father,' when you see him every single day?" Colossians chapter 1, verse 15. The Son is the image of who? The invisible God. The firstborn over all creation. If you want to know what God really looks like, if there's any question in your mind is, what image should I have of God? He said, look at Jesus. Colossians chapter 1, verse 19. For in him, in Christ, in Jesus, all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell. Therefore, in Jesus, we see a more radical, a more accurate image of God. If your image of God is distorted, I challenge you to go back to the Gospels. I challenge you to go back and reflect on the life of Christ. Meditate on Jesus so that your image of God can be brought back to a more biblical mindset. So we know that Jesus is the true image of God. So when you think about God, you should think about who? You should think about Jesus. I'm going to take this a step further. As believers, we are people, men and women, created in the image of Christ. Believers are blessed with the ability to bear a more accurate image of God. In Romans chapter 8, verse 29, Paul says, "For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to what? To be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters." God had it already planned out in his mind before he created earth. He predestined every believer in Christ to be in the image of Jesus, his Son. That's powerful, church. Because when we think about Christ being the image of God, God says, "I want believers of me to image Christ, who is the image of God. Therefore, we too can look like." what does God do for us? God equips believers to restore his image. In Ephesians chapter 2, verses 22 through 24, Paul says, "You were taught with regard to your former way of life to put off your old self, which has been corrupted by its deceitful desires, to be made new in the attitude of your minds, and to put on the new self," listen to this, "created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness." God has equipped us with his Spirit the moment we obey the gospel, the moment we submit ourselves to baptism. The Bible says in Acts 2:38 that we receive the gift of what? The Holy Spirit. The Bible says that the fullness of God dwelt in Jesus, but God also gives us a portion of himself to live in us for the purpose of looking like him. Amen, church. And how does this happen? Paul says that we ought to be made new in the attitude of our hearts, that we must be willing to change our way of thinking, the way we think about people, the way we think about sin, the way we think about this world, the way we think about ourselves. Our attitude must continually be renewed. And he says this, to put on the new self by doing what? By living a life of righteousness and holiness. Church, that's sanctification. It means I'm setting aside my life for God's purpose. I'm setting aside my life to be what God wants me to be. Which means there are certain things I won't do anymore. There are certain words that will no longer come out of my mouth, because I have chosen to be an image bearer of God. There's a certain way I will treat sinners. There's a certain way I'll treat outsiders. There's a certain way I'll treat members of the Lord's church, because I am an image bearer of God. I'm going to treat people the way Christ would treat people. Amen, church. It is our responsibility to live our lives as representatives of God, acting in the same way that he would. And I know we still fail miserably. I know we still have areas in which we need to grow. I struggle in that area, but we truly need to take the challenge to restore the image of God. Amen. If our image of God is stored in our hearts, and it is, we also have a responsibility towards our heart to guard it and take those distorted images captive. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 4 through 5. The Bible says, "The weapons we fight are not the weapons of this world. On the contrary, they have divine power to demolish strongholds. We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God." Listen to this. Paul says, "We take captive every thought and make it obedient to Christ." We take captive every distorted image of God and we make it obedient to Christ. We have a responsibility to challenge any distorted images of God that may be in our heart of hearts. How do we do this? What is our role? I think that we need to surround ourselves with people who truly exhibit God's image. That's the remedy. image bearers of God, whether in our righteous state or our sinful state, in order to gain a more accurate description of who God is and how he relates to us, we need to surround ourselves with people who truly try to look like God. Do you isolate yourself from the church? Do you only see believers on Sunday morning? Or do you interact with them through the week? Do you call? Do you text? Do you pray? Do you fellowship with other believers? It's important because of images and our relationships with one another is responsible for our distorted view of God, then we can challenge that by being around more godly people. Amen, church. And if we meet people in the world who have not obeyed the gospel, or people who have fallen away from the church, we have a responsibility to them too. We have a responsibility to image God in their lives, not condemn them, not judge them into hell, but to show them Christ in the way we relate to them. And hopefully, through our example, they can have a more accurate or reformed image of God. Galatians chapter 3, verse 27. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. If you're here this morning and maybe you haven't given your life to God, maybe you haven't submitted yet to the gospel, you haven't submitted to baptism for the forgiveness of your sins, to be added to the church, to receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. The Bible says once we are baptized, once we are immersed in water, our old self is done away with. That we put on who? Christ. That when people see us in our saved state, when God sees us in our saved state, they don't see the old person who once lived a life of sin and rebellion. They see who? They should see Christ. When God looks at you through obedience to baptism, you've repented of your former life, he sees Christ. You are, in God's image, his son. If there's anyone here this morning that needs to respond in any way, just let that be known as we all together sing. Stand and sing the song of